instead of appreciating people as they are, I mean, that's what you referred us should be doing. Now, this is a love for him, one an intellectual virtue, in that sense it is goes beyond it. Seeking to know, discovering and becoming are three stages of spiritual development towards the recognition of the divine light of love that guides us. Reason or cognitive knowledge is only the beginning of this discernment. He says, love, however, I will explain or describe. We humans will be speechless in defining love. Reason, although pen writes everything, it turns paralyzed when it comes to love. So sometimes cannot be, rationally cannot be explained, but it must be lived. Two forms of discernment here. So his evidence is for sun. Sun itself. You search for evidence, do not turn away from the sun. Love is something like that. Sun lightens, the universe or the world we know, and it is his own witness or the it is love is in human beings as something like that. It is proven by giving, just like the sun enlightens around, and it is this light is its own evidence. If people recognize the spiritual worth of every existence, which who are in majority in most of the societies, actually, as you notice, tranquility and peace will prevail. Just like all men need to be learned a profession in order to earn a living, everybody needs to learn the art of religion, which is rewarded by love. Mesnevi, I'm quoting here, for this reason, Rumi tells us, my mother is love, father is love. You see, they are all people given. My prophet is love, my God is love, I am love child. I'm a love child. And I come to tell about love to the world. You see, this is how we should show that from the ordinary life, our fathers, mothers, ordinary people are given. So we should emphasize this instead of the other one thing. The other form of discernment is the moral discernment. So it has to do also the moral development of ourselves. So it is this as a the absence of love are as moral virtue is responsible for the degradation of human situation. One reason for this degradation is the confusion between desire and the love. You see, there are two kinds of desire. One is directed to opposite nature, as I said. I shouldn't go into this. I already touched this. To a different desire for the opposite nature, desire for the same nature. But love comes from our own nature. So if we take the example of ordinary family relations, when a woman desire each other sexually because they lack that the other have. But if they respect each other, they desire their nature of the same as a person, as a human being. And if they desire the other as they have something more than I have, it turns into a real, what is called amor in Latin, or the Latin, I don't use the English word love now, okay? Because That is ishq or aşk in Arabic term, but in more Muslim languages, it is recognized. It is over all of these. If you respect your, you know, spouse as a divine gift, having some, you know, divine spirit in him or her, then even as this kind of desire, so trying to get into that secret of life, then you are in love. Otherwise, you are either after natural instincts or just want to, you know, to be respected as a person from another, you know, fellow man or woman. That is some couples, when they are get old, they still quarrel because no desire are left, and they don't respect each other as person, and they don't discover, because Rumi says, because people are too involved in daily errands and they forgot their own self, actually. So this is how moral development, discernment. Therefore, moral virtue here, these are three moral virtues here: humility, openness, and care. So our pettiness, arrogance, you know, prevent us recognizing the other people's worth. That's why he said, you learn love when you become me. You take me as yourself. Because we are all arrogant. That's why we always, I mean, the history of religions are full of description of people, you know, their arrogancy turned into a, you know, resistance to God and to the values and things like that. Because of the arrogance, now let me quote something. Care is a virtue of man who makes his bodily desire submitted to the will or the heart's desire. Desire to actualize man's true self. If man cares about his being in the world, if I borrow the Heideggerian term, or basic necessity of his existence, it means he is turning a blind eye to the being towards beyond. Because the other people are always beyond us. We have to think them, they are better than us. Instead of thinking ourselves always better than the others. You see, because if we don't give somebody in need, because we think that they must have made big mistakes or, you know, terrible things, and so they deserve their current situation. Yeah, either ethnically or otherwise, you know, they deserve this. If they apply for us a job, we say, you don't dress like us. But because he doesn't have. Because when you see all people dressed, they have like uniforms. You see, this is our uniform, academician. And you see them in dirty clothes, and he begs you for something that you say, oh, he's a lazy man. Anyway, Rumi points out that moral virtues of humility, openness, and care for the character development let the human actions reflect the primordial perfection of human soul in its in the mirror of fellow human beings. Actually, we others are not other, our others, the counter image. Others are our mirrors. If we refuse giving We are denying our own self, actually. It means I don't have, I'm already empty. For not, for what? For body. Yeah, we emptied our, only we emptied every energy for the bodily existence. We don't have anything to give to you. Yeah, I'm not trying to show you that I'm a virtuous man, but I don't get anything from this meeting in terms of material. And I know many colleagues who, if they get it to the, down to the dime, every money from the government, they will go to a meeting, okay? Or who invites them. If they want, if it involves spending from their pocket, they don't care. What? For what? You see? Because they always get used to taking. They are not trained in giving. When I received this invitation, I took, even if they don't pay me the trip to university, I will do it. Because this whole paper is based on this.
Next time I'll speak with you.
I have to be, I don't, I mean, I can't contradict myself here. So if Rumi is right, somebody show it. Yeah, it's so you can judge his ideas on the logical level too. It's open to that. But for human beings are all mirrors for each other. Human life is part of a dynamic process in which not only moral virtues are realized, but also possibilities of infinite happiness are achieved. Moral life, which requires men to make free choices, is the mark of humanity. Choosing to love others is also a decision that can be made by free agents who achieve this freedom from petty desires. You see? We become free as we relinquish our petty desires. Not free from other people. It's quite contrary to the modern understanding of, you know, I can do whatever. Yeah, I want, I desire. They are becoming, the slaves of their own desires. They are not free, actually. Or for fame, or anything else. For Rumi, man's burden is to become free and freely share the perfection bestowed on women at the moment of primordial creation by God. I'm skipping here. God created angels, brutes, and men. These are three kinds of creations that shows the degree of their freedom. Even angels are not free in that sense, because they depend on God in terms of their, like, automats. They can do only what God delegate them to. But the human beings can do both ways. Things he delegate and things that he says, don't do it, just at the, like they did at the creation. So it is a sign of freedom, actually, but this is not doing is also a sign of freedom, but human beings, by becoming slaves of their own self, not the personality, probably, if we make a distinction. So just to cut it short, the intellect is helpless in expounding love as a summary. It is love alone that can offer the explanation of love. Although love is a motive behind all the creation, it defies all definition, all description. Just like we can't explain the creation because we were not there. You see? The love is an end to itself, and the price of the love is the life itself. For the lover, come by it easy and cheap. He cannot give his consent to throw it away. Through the power of love, he frees himself or herself from the bondage of life and attains a treasure, value of which cannot be set in terms of wealth, power, or possessions. Since, here I'm quoting his line, since in each heart there is a window to other hearts. They are not separated and shut off like two bodies. Unlike the bodies which are close to each other or each enclosed within itself, hearts join together without losing the individuality of the self. Rumi makes a parallel between heart body and the candelier, glass and the light. A candelier, chandeliers or candelier, what's the right one in English? Chandeliers. Okay, chandeliers, light, sometimes I think it's French or so. Thus, even though two lamp dishes remain to be not joined, yet either line is united in a single way. You see, there are many lamps, but their lights join together. You can see the division into a single way. So in conclusion, Rumi believes in that is the religion of love. In his inimitable way, he tells us that love is a divine gift entrusted into him over and over again, into human beings. The highest end of that human love must lead is not only an individual morality and self-realization, but also social moral order, and that reflects the peace within and without. For him, life is so short, it should not be wasted away by meaningless hatred and bloodshed, because this is our fight for getting something, always. We should all live the good life here, because nobody will live on indefinitely. Thus, Rumi echoes the call of his contemporary, another 13th century Sufi poet, Yunus Emre, who wrote in Turkish, I'm not here on earth for strife. Love is the mission of my life. This is a very famous line from him in Turkish. Thank you very much for your patience.
We need to relearn these things. And of course, first presentation to rediscover us as persons could be linked with what it means the personal level. Maybe Rumi is here.
Yes, self, ego, person, we have here. Yeah.
So, we have to move out to Africa, to three kinds of Africa. Professor Ernest Beazara from Catholic University of East Africa is online, waiting for a presentation called How Intercultural Encounters Reshape the Contemporary World, the Africa Experience. So let's try to see if we have a good Skype now. No. next time we will be on 3D. So we are ready to hear your presentation. We need maybe to speak a little louder for your sound to be a little higher. Okay.
The reason why I put it is, do you hear any better?
Maybe a little louder. I think it's okay.
It's okay.
We will concentrate
okay.
on your.
It's
okay. Can you hear? Can you hear us?
Yes, yes. We can hear you very well.
I'm asking the public. Yes. Okay. So we are ready. I already presented your title. Yes.
Okay. So first and foremost, greetings to everybody. And I thank you very much for this opportunity. The purpose of this paper is to share the African experience in how intercultural encounters have shaped and are still shaping on the contemporary world. And I concentrate only on the African experience. Now I have got 8 ideas to share with you. And the first one is that contemporary Africa is a mixture of tradition and modern. The contemporary Africa has been reshaped from the traditional Africa. And the modern Africa has not yet taken enough roots